Well, let's go ahead and turn in our Bibles to Philippians chapter 4 as we continue our journey through. Paul now is starting to wrap up his epistle to the Philippians. Since chapter 4 started, he has given the Philippians really a long thank you note as he signs off in the final chapter of the epistle. And we saw last week and the week before that he focused on God's peace as a result of prayer. It was the peace that passes all understanding will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And then he went to right thinking in verse 8. He wanted us to meditate on those wonderful Christian virtues, those things that we should be thinking about all the time and creating those neural pathways, those grooves, if you will, in our thinking. Because verse 8 leads to verse 9, which said, practice these things. Do these things. These things do. It was a command that Paul issued. And he said, the God of peace will be with you. Now, as we go to verses 10 through 13 today, he is going to take that peace and tell you where it leads. The peace of God will lead to contentment. And that's what he's focusing in on verses 10 through 13. The satisfaction that you and I have, that spiritual fulfillment and contentment that we have from God's peace being in our life. So let's go ahead and read through 10 through 13. It says, but I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at last your care for me has flourished again. Though you surely didn't care, you lacked the opportunity. Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So Paul here actually issues four characteristics of the contented person. Four things that you and I should have as manifestations from our life. And these are things that peace should yield. And like I said, that contentment we're talking about is that deep, overflowing spiritual satisfaction that you and I have together. And it's interesting, we live in a time in the 21st century that the probably number one problem is dissatisfaction. You know, we're not satisfied with our spouse, we get another. We're not satisfied with our home, we get a bigger one. We're not satisfied with our car, we get a faster one. We're not satisfied with our body, we go try to change it. We're never satisfied, it seems. But God has given us a way to be content and satisfied, not from our outward circumstances or the things that come to our lives, but through the inward indwelling of the Holy Spirit in you through Christ Jesus. You see, if you want to title this message today, you can title it, The Secret to Contentment. The Secret to Contentment. And Paul issues four characteristics that we should be aware of. Notice he says in verse 10, but I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now, at last, your care for me has flourished again. Though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. So the first characteristic of contentment is the person who joyfully reflects on God's providential provision. God provides through providential means, and some people have a hard time understanding what providence is. Providence is God working in the world through natural means to bring about his purposes. It's not supernatural per se. It's not a miracle. It is providence. In fact, the word providence is composed of two different words, pro, which means before, and video, which means to see. So pro video literally means not only that God knows things in advance and sees things in advance, but he works out things in the natural world in advance. And you can see different examples of these through history. On D-Day in June, you know that the Allies had to invade Normandy. They had to go across the channel, but they were in the middle of a storm. And there was only a certain amount of time before that storm would cease and resume again. It was perhaps the space of about a day. And in God's providence, God allowed a fog bank to precede the invading ships. so the enemy could not see those ships until they were right there at the shore, maybe a mile offshore. Usually you'd be able to see for miles across the channel. So that surprise perhaps even changed the outcome of the entire World War II. But also you see providence being had in the scriptures as well, over and over again, such as Joseph. Joseph was sold into slavery. He was thrown into a pit. He was betrayed by his brothers. He was sent to Egypt. And God's providential care knew that Egypt was going to experience a famine. He knew that Canaan would experience this radical famine, that if there was no food in the area, the whole region would perish. But yet God in his providence worked out Joseph being risen to second ruler in the kingdom behind Pharaoh. He instituted a famine policy based on the interpretation of Pharaoh's dream. He exercised his wisdom, stored food for years, and then when the famine came, he could feed the whole region. That's God's providence. That's his providential care. And what we see here in verse 10 is Paul rejoicing greatly at God's providential care from the Philippians. Remember, the Philippians cared for Paul. They supported him with financial gifts when he went to Thessalonica after he left Philippi and also into Corinth. But there was a time that they lost track of Paul. We don't know what this means, but you lacked opportunity. Okay, that might be that they lost track of where Paul was perhaps, or they fell on some financial hard times and they weren't able to support Paul financially. But what we can do and what we can take from this is notice that the word care here, your last, you cared, but I rejoice greatly in the Lord. Now, at last, your care is in the present tense. It was a constant caring. It was a habitual caring. It was a caring that never ceased, and that's what that present tense gives us. But I love the word here, flourished, because it literally is a horticulture term. It had to do with plants. And so Paul is saying that he's rejoicing in the blooming or the flowering of their care for Paul. And sometimes plants go dormant, and sometimes they flower, some more than others. And that's God's providential care too. We should expect God to providentially care for us, but he may not do it the same way, in the same frequency, with the same method each and every time. And Paul understood this. As he sat in that prison, you know, some 800 miles away from Philippi, he certainly can rejoice in this flowering or this blooming of the care and concern. Not that it ever went away. Remember, present tense caring means the caring continued through, but there is certain opportunity for people to give and certain opportunities that are taken away, where the Lord seems to shut a door, he seems to open a door over here. So let us not get stuck in this rut that God has to provide the same way in the same means every single time. But the point here, notice that the Philippians lacked opportunity. You know, some of us have the opportunity but lack the care or concern. And that's what we need to guard against. If you see a brother or a sister in need and you have the opportunity, why not help? Why not give them a boost? Why not, you know, make sure that your sister or brother in Christ is taken care of in the Lord with that opportunity? But there are some of us that do lack the opportunity but have concern. The Philippians seem to have both most of the time. But there was a period of about 8 years between the time that Paul left the Philippian church and then Epaphroditus gave him a gift here, and now Paul's responding with the epistle to the Philippians, back to them, thanking them and rejoicing for them. So, you know, God's providential care is very important to remember, that God is working ahead of time. Though we don't know his purposes, he certainly is working, and you shouldn't lose confidence in that. We should take this principle that the contented person rejoices in the Lord's providential provision for you and I. You know, can you think back at times where you were cared for? There was an unexpected gift, perhaps, or somebody knocking at your door that boosted you and brought you forward and gave you that little oomph that you needed to move along and to, you know, go forward in Christ. You know, you can remember probably oftentimes, maybe it comes from unsuspecting times, but God is always concerned. He always has the opportunity. You know, he could have changed Paul's circumstances at any time We understand that. He was all powerful. He's all loving. And he can do that anytime. But instead of changing Paul's circumstances every time, he was more interested in changing Paul. You see, God wants to change you through your need. He wants to have you rejoice because you trusted in God to provide for you. He wants to change your heart from the inside out and change your mind from the inside out. And when that happens, Saul became Paul. You know, Cephas became Peter. Okay, he gives us a new name and a new confidence in our step. So what a wonderful thing to remember that we should always rejoice in the confidence that God's providential care will be working. He goes on to verse 11 and he says, "Now that I speak in regard to need, not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content." What a great statement this is, because the word he uses here for learned is manthano. Manthano is a person who learns through experience. It's closely related to the word mathetes, which means disciple, or a learner and follower of Jesus Christ. You see, Paul had learned these things. These weren't things that were intuitively given to Paul at birth. These are things that are not natural for us to do. See, it's unnatural for us to be content and to be satisfied. He said he had to learn these things, and that's what God does when he brings or permits that trial or tribulation to come to your life. He is wanting you to learn. He's wanting you to trust further. He's wanting you to rejoice when God finally takes care of the problem that you might be going through. And that's indeed how most of us learn. We learn through experience, manthano. It's something that God has done in our life, maybe something that has knocked on our door, but that is something that doesn't come naturally to us. We have to make a conscious decision to be content and to be satisfied with what God provides us. Whatever home you have, enjoy it and be satisfied with it. Your spouse, be satisfied. Allow your spouse to satisfy you. Be satisfied in the person that God has brought to you throughout your life. Your kids, be satisfied in them. Any kind of relationship, your employer, be satisfied with it. Now, this doesn't mean to say simply capitulate and just give up and allow circumstances to just dictate your life for the worse. But it means that recognize that God has you in a position now for a certain purpose and a reason, though you may not know it. And that's the perfect time to learn contentment. And that's what Paul did. He said, in whatever state I am, to be content. Notice there's two forms of the verb to be here, back to back. Whatever state I am, and then to be content. That tells you when they're back to back like that, that state that he is currently in or that you might be currently in, to be content can match it. It can match whatever state you're in. In other words, contentment is not sent to flight by whatever crazy state you might be in or every condition that God allows to come to your life. You're somebody who can have everything through God's grace that can meet the moment, in other words. And when you suffer trial, it's always in the present tense, is it? And when you're in contentment, you're always in the present tense. So try not to look too far ahead or look too far back, or you might miss that wonderful present tense contentment for where you are now. Remember, guys, the Bible says today is the day of salvation. God said, I am the great I am. That's where he works in the present tense. And that's where all of us, that's where life happens, always in the present tense. You never live in the future. You never live in the past. You always live in the present. When you got married, you were in the present, right? When you came to Christ, it was the present tense. You're sitting right here now in the present tense. The past is gone. The future hasn't arrived. It's the present tense to be content. Be content now. Don't wait. I'll be content as soon as I get this. Or I'll be content as soon as that person that did something to me in the past apologizes. No, God's grace is sufficient for today. It's for today. And so when he says content here, he has a whole lot of meaning packed into this word. And Paul, again, just to remind you, he's under house arrest, chained to a Roman guard with an 18-inch chain, a houlos chain. and he's there, and most likely he's sharing the faith. But Paul was actually free when he was in prison because he had Christ. Remember, he never says, I'm a prisoner of Rome. I never said, I'm a prisoner of Nero. He's always a prisoner of Jesus Christ. He saw his prison as purpose and meaning. And when he uses this word content, he takes a word that was used in classical culture to mean a whole host and a range of things. Autarkes. Autarkes was a word that some meant self-sufficiency or self-containment. One secular writer uses autarkes as a word to describe a country that needed no imports, needed nothing to be piped in from the outside. In fact, that country was self-sufficient, had all the right resources, had all the right, you know, gold and silver, had the shipping fleet, had everything they needed, fully self-contained and contentment. In fact, Warren Wiersbe says that content here means contained. Contained. But beyond this, there was a philosophical school called the Stoics. You ever heard of the Stoics? The Stoics were those philosophers that tried to control their own will and their own emotions. That's why the word Stoic means you're just deadpan face, you know. They tried to, in their own power, you know, harness their will and what they desired because they felt that desire brought suffering and pain. Okay, so the Stoics wanted to control their emotions and reactions to any suffering or pain into the affairs of life. They resigned themselves totally to the will of God, these philosophers. In fact, they show up in Acts chapter 17 on Mars Hill as well. There were Stoics and Epicureans. There were the pantheists that believed that all is God and God is all, and the Epicureans, the hedonists or are agnostics today. So Paul takes this word autarkes, which is only used here in the New Testament very uniquely, and he infuses it with a wonderful sense of meaning. And it literally, for Paul, means a divinely bestowed self-sufficiency. Divinely bestowed self-sufficiency. That is something that he can only say because Christ lived in him, because the Holy Spirit lived in him. It wasn't no need simply because of the things he did and the works he did to bring himself into an isolated situation. It was the need that was provided for by Christ in him. You see, let Christ satisfy you. Amen. Let that divine bestowal of self-sufficiency and that power to strengthen you, to bring and overcome any trial you might be going through, because that is the only answer for humanity. It is the only answer for our insatiable appetite. Our constant dissatisfaction can only be quenched by an overflowing of the Spirit of God in Christ in your life. You see, some of us are like cups. You know, some of us are cups. What do you do with a cup? You fill it up with a liquid. Let's say you put it underneath your kitchen faucet. You turn it upside down, and the water just bounces off the cup, right? And people wonder, why am I not full of the Spirit? Why am I not satisfied and content? Well, because you might have to change your relationship to the constant outpouring of the Holy Spirit in your life. It may be that you have to come closer to the Lord. It may be you need to spend more time in prayer and reading the Word. You all know what that might be. So I'm not saying you have to work for it to earn it. I'm just saying that the relationship might have to change. Once you turn that cup and bring a different relationship to that water that comes out of the faucet, then the cup is overflowing and constant. You see, God is like that constant overflowing of water. He is never changing. He gives you the entire being of himself. Remember, the Holy Spirit is not given by measure. He doesn't give you a quart here and a pint there and a quarter of himself here. He gives all of himself to you. You see, God is one. There is no parts in God. Either you have him or you don't. Right. And if that relationship changes, then you'll find your life being overflowed with God's provision. And then you find this great contentment that comes. Now, the second characteristic here in verse 11 is the contented person is one who learned to live above the circumstances. Now, Paul's circumstances were great, and they were many. He was shipwrecked 3 times. He spent a night in the deep and a day in the deep floating in the ocean. He was beaten with rods, he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, many times. He was imprisoned. He was in the perils of robbers, thieves. He was on pains of death, in prison multiple times. Paul had all kinds of situations to be concerned about. But it's wonderful that he kept his mind and his thoughts on heavenly realities, not on these temporal circumstances. Notice what he said in 2 Corinthians 4:17. For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comprehension.
Amen.
That short flash of a trial is going to work in you to develop the trust God wants you to have in him. Remember, he could have changed the circumstances any time, but he's more interested in changing you. And that's what his mission and purpose is. Someone once said that God is most glorified when we are most satisfied in him. He is most glorified when we're most satisfied in him. Augustine even said, our heart is restless until it finds its rest in thee. Until you learn, like Paul, Manthano, by experience, through your trials, to trust God and to make him that person who's going to give you the strength to work through it, then we will always be dissatisfied. So notice how he goes on to verse 12. Paul now shares the various conditions that challenge contentment. He says, I know how to be abased and know how to abound. Everything and in all things I have learned, both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and suffer need. So all the conditions that Paul had worked itself out to where he could be content and satisfied even though hunger and filling were at his doorstep constantly. So the third characteristic of the contented person is that the satisfied person is content with whatever God provides. You thank him for what he provides. You don't say, this is not enough, and start complaining about what you don't have. You start rejoicing and thanking him for what you do have. Now, again, he revisits in verse 12. He says, I know. That's intuitive insight. Paul became aware of his experience and what God has done through him. He says, how to be abased. That means live humbly. And I know how to abound. That means to live in prosperity. Everything, everywhere. That means every location and in every situation. And in all things, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry. Now, this term learned here is very interesting because literally in the Greek text, it says, I have learned a secret. A secret. He uses a very unique word here again. And this is the secret to contentment. Now, when he says that, just know that the word he chose here was used in different applications. The most prominent one was the initiation into the Greek mystery religions. It was, I have learned a secret, much like being initiated into the Greek mystery religions that one couldn't just walk into and know everything. You see, the Greek mysteries prided themselves in you having some secret, sacred kind of knowledge. But Paul here is saying that he has learned the secret to both be full and to hungry and to be hungry, both to abound and suffer need. And he's going to share the secret with you in verse 13. Now, notice what he says in verse 13. He's going to reveal the secret of being content here. He says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What an amazing secret that is. Well, the cat's out of the bag and there's no secret anymore. The Bible's been around for 2,000 years in the New Testament. And this is something that we should have been knowing from the moment we were saved, is that Christ is working in you to give you the power to succeed. His grace is overflowing on you to give you the power to succeed and the strength. So the fourth characteristic of the contented person is one who relies on the power of God. Yield to the power of God. Some of us haven't yielded to him. Yield to him. Let him have his way with you. Let him change your heart, change your mind. Let him have access to everything about you. Because yielding is what the writers of the New Testament did. Peter says these were writers who were yielded to the Holy Spirit who wrote out the scriptures. So what a wonderful thing this is to know that if we yield to Christ, Him living in us is going to give us the power we need to overcome and even change us. Now, I love this little phrase, I can do. It literally means I have strength. I have strength to do, or to be strong, or to have power or resources. It's to be effective, even. But I like it, it's in the present active. That means you can do all the time these things. And it's in the active voice, and that means the subject does the action of the verb. In other words, he's telling you, God's not going to do this for you. It's you that has to do these things. But you have to do them in one of two ways. You can either rely on your own strength to do them and be dissatisfied and discontent in the end and probably fail, or you can do it in the power of the Holy Spirit who strengthens you, the Christ who strengthens you. See, there's two ways to go in life. White knuckling it, you know, squeezing and trying to really get things going in your own power. Well, that leads to burnout. But you see, we serve an inexhaustible God. There is no burnout in God. He's self-contained. He has no need from outside. He is totally self-sufficient. The theologians would call that aseity. Aseity is self-existence. He doesn't need to plug into a wall to get his power, in other words. You are the same way. You simply need to be plugged into Jesus. And Jesus is a limitless resource to help us succeed in everything we want to do. He says in all things, that's all is panta. It's all big and little. Small, huge, or large, or minuscule, all things. Now, it's interesting here that the phrase all things appears before the phrase I can do in the Greek text. So what he's saying to you is that he's emphasizing the all things here. He's saying the all things is what I want you to focus on. Not necessarily you doing them, but it's God that can meet you anywhere and everywhere you are. That should give you great comfort. Knowing that God is able. You ever heard that phrase, God is able? Able to do what? Anything. He can do anything with you. He can take anything that you're going through and turn it around. So it's wonderful that he put this all things here because it was possible that Paul was strong enough in Christ to overcome all his material needs. But this verse is greatly misunderstood. Well, all things, I can do all things in Christ. That means I can go down and I want my Mercedes Benz. I'm going to pray for that. And God, you're going to empower me to get that. You know, no, the context is his material needs, the things he needs to sustain himself ultimately. So it's all things in accordance with God's commands, his callings, and his will in your life. Notice through shows you the vehicle through which the strength comes. It's through Christ who strengthens. Literally, it's strengthening. Christ who is constantly, presently strengthening me. Now, he's not speaking of a prideful self-sufficiency in his own abilities, but God's self-sufficiency. And Paul is still following God. He's not saying, I'm the guy, I'm the man. I'm going to, you know, buff my fingernails because I've done this in my own self-sufficiency. Remember in the Old Testament, remember the children that wandered in the wilderness, the Israelites, for 40 years? They were instructed in a way to follow God. Do you remember what it was? It was to stay behind the pillar of fire by night and the cloud by day. They were not to get in front of that or they wouldn't know where they were going. If you get too close to that, you're taking your life into your own hands. But you also remember under Joshua when they had to go into Canaan land to conquer the land and take it from the Canaanites. They said, remain a healthy distance behind the Ark of the Covenant. Stay back behind the priests. And sometimes God gives us a Jordan River crossing to overcome our obstacles and trials. And sometimes he gives us a Red Sea parting to overcome our trials and obstacles. That's two kinds of faith, two kinds of options, two kinds of paths. You see, sometimes in life, God will part the Red Sea for you, and there's not much you have to do. You just need to travel on dry ground through. It's all before you laid out. And there's other times in life where you're going to be told to start walking into the Jordan River, even though the river is not parted yet. Remember what it said? The water came up to the ankles, and then to the knees, then to the thigh, then to the waist. And they're probably thinking at that point, what am I doing? I'm carrying this ark. And all the people are probably on the shore just watching. Oh my gosh, they're going to drown. We're going to drown. You know? But the faith they had to keep obeying God and walking through that, something happened upstream, if you remember the story. And the water subsided, and they crossed over to do what God has called them to do. You and I need to remember that it's the Christ in us that gives us the ability and that grace to give you the strength to overcome anything, anything in your life. Remember, all things. You can do all things. That's in the emphatic position. It's up front. That means there's nothing too great for God. There's things too great for us, but nothing too great for God, ultimately. So, you know, as we take from this Paul's encouragement to be content, remember who strengthens you. It's through Christ. If your cup is turned upside down, well, it's time to turn it right side up. It's time to be overflowing with God's strength. The only person, the only way that you can be cut off from God's strength as a believer is to remove your fellowship with the Lord. There's no way you can. Nobody can take it or steal it from you. Only you. We need to self-examine. You know, examine yourself to see whether you're in the faith. Examine yourself to see whether you're a cup right side up to overflowing. And if you're not, today's the day to get right. Amen. Go to the Lord with your sins or with your troubles or whatever it might be and keep that right relationship with Christ. And you can't help but to succeed and be strengthened and ultimately be content and satisfied with what God has given you. Okay? All right, let's all stand together and let's thank God for what He's done to get you to this point. You know, this point is a monumental point. He's got you to today, the present tense. And tomorrow when you wake up, it'll be the present moment again. But remember, whatever state I am, you can be content, present tense. It's enough to meet the challenge of the state of the day. Okay, let's pray together. Dear Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for filling us with your Spirit and to give us your Son, who is the source of power to walk the Christian life and to overcome any need, whether it's material or spiritual. Father, we ask that you would help us to trust you and your providential provision for us, Lord, and to rejoice as we receive it, knowing that it comes from your hand, and therefore that makes us thankful. So, Lord, the peace that comes through prayer and through right thinking and through right living, Lord, I know will lead to contentment because you told the Philippians that nearly 2,000 years ago. And it's still the same today. So, Father, break into our life. Help us through your power of your Spirit to walk that Christian life the way that pleases you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.